Hello everyone, in this video we're going to talk about Rh negative pregnancy. Whenever the term Rh negative pregnancy comes into picture, there are two things happening. Firstly, in any pregnancy, there's the mother and the child. So in Rh negative pregnancy, the mother will be having Rh negative blood group and the child will be a Rh positive blood group. So what does this negative and positive mean? On any RBC, if the D antigen or the rhesus antigen, if it is present, it means it is Rh positive. So a Rh positive RBC will have a Rh antigen on its surface. Whereas an Rh negative RBC will lack this rhesus antigen on its surface. So mother is having Rh negative and child is having Rh positive. During a pregnancy, due to some circumstances, if this Rh positive RBC of the child will enter the maternal circulation by some or the other means. Normally, there will be no mixing of the fetal blood and the maternal blood, but under certain circumstances, if this RBC, fetal RBC, enters into the maternal circulation. See, for the mother's circulation, because the mother's RBC does not have this rhesus antigen, this will act as a foreign body. It is a foreign antigen because it's not present. This antigen, our rhesus antigen, is foreign to the maternal circulation. So the maternal circulation will recognize this as something different. It's not belonging to that body, and that circulation, the WBCs in the maternal circulation, will start secreting antibodies to this rhesus antigen. So this is called as anti-rhesus antibody. These will be produced in the maternal circulation. And once these antibodies are produced, because this is the first time the body is encountering this antigen, the amount of antibodies produced will be quite less. They will bind to the rhesus antigen here. And finally, this fetal RBC, which has entered into the maternal circulation, will be killed by the reticuloendothelial system of the mother. So now, the small amount of fetal RBCs which have entered into the maternal circulation have been killed. So this scenario is over. But this whole process where the maternal circulation encounters the rhesus antigen for the first time from the fetal circulation, produces antibodies and kills these RBCs, this process is called as sensitization. Remember, this is the first encounter, and hence what will be the type of antibodies produced here? It will be IgM type, and the speciality of IgM type is it will not cross the placental barrier. So the killing of fetal RBCs will be restricted to those RBCs which have entered into the circulation. So this IgM will not cross the placenta. This is what happens in the first pregnancy or the first encounter. What about the subsequent pregnancies? Let's consider the second pregnancy. So what happens during the second pregnancy? Already the mother's circulations has antibodies. But more importantly, when these antibodies are produced in the first encounter, there is something, the B cells of the maternal circulation have something called as memory. So when the next time this Rh positive RBC enters into the maternal circulation, these B cells which are having the memory, they are ready and they produce a lot of antibodies. And because this is the second exposure, the amount depend because of the adaptive immunity, the amount of antibodies produced is very huge and they are very fast in origin. But more importantly, they are IgG type. And the speciality of IgG type is they can cross the placental barrier. Once they cross the placental barrier, this huge number of antibodies will start killing all the Rh positive RBCs which are present in the fetus. And this happens very fast. And because of this, there will be consequences. Now there are two things happening whenever the fetal RBC are destroyed. So they are dying. So what will happen when the RBCs die? Large number of RBCs are being destroyed by the maternal antibodies. So because of this, two things will happen. Firstly, the oxygen carrying capacity of the fetal blood will reduce. At the same time, because of the over destruction of these RBCs, there will be increased production of bilirubin. Remember, whenever there is a type of hemolytic anemia going on, this bilirubin initially will be unconjugated. So, decreased oxygen carrying capacity of blood, this leads to fetal anemia. Okay? Now, this anemia, if it's profound, there's too much destruction of RBCs, the RBC is not able to carry oxygen to the cells of the body, this leads to anoxemia. So this is a condition where the oxygen present in the fetal blood will be less. It's not enough to supply all the cells in the body. So what does anoxemia lead to? It will start killing the cells, any normal cells also. So it will start affecting different organs of the body. One such organ which is affected like this will be the liver. We'll come to liver a little bit later. This bilirubin, which is produced by excessive RBC destruction, is initially unconjugated. So this goes to the liver, so that will get conjugated and will get excreted through the system, extrahepatic biliary system. But remember, fetal liver is not fully developed. Okay, it's not developed enough to handle this large amount of bilirubin which is being produced. So in the end, because of the excess of bilirubin, the child will present with jaundice. So once there is jaundice, because of too much of bilirubin which is present, that bilirubin can go and affect the brain of the developing fetus and cause a condition called as kernicterus, which is very dangerous to the development of the fetus. Now, two things are happening to the liver. Because you should remember that liver is an important organ for the production of RBCs in the fetus. Whenever there is anemia, to compensate for the anemia, the liver starts to produce more number of RBCs. And for that, it will undergo hypertrophy and hyperplasia, and it will go enlargement. So the liver, which was almost of this size, it will increase in size. So as to compensate for the anemia, it will start producing more RBCs. And in that condition, the immature RBCs are present more in the peripheral smear. And hence, erythroblastosis is present. This anemia in the fetus can lead to congestive cardiac failure, okay? And this is almost fatal. So there can be CCF happening, there can be enlargement of the liver happening, and there is erythroblastosis. That's why this condition is called erythroblastosis fetalis. One more thing, because there is damage to the liver cells are getting damaged by the anoxemia, and hence there will be decreased protein production. And once there is decreased protein production, that time there will be decreased oncotic pressure in the plasma, and that will lead to something called as edema. So edema can be because of liver injury causing decreased protein, or even CCF can lead to edema. Now this edema can be occurring in different parts of the body. It can occur in the subcutaneous tissue of the lower limbs, upper limbs, scalp. It can occur in the cavities. So depending on which cavity is affected, if pleural space is affected, it can lead to pleural effusion. If pericardial space is affected, it can lead to pericardial effusion. And if abdomen is affected, that is a peritoneum, then it can lead to ascites. All this condition, if the child is in failure with presence of edema, that condition will be called as hydrops fetalis. And because all this condition is occurring because of an immune response, primarily it's an immune response which is destroying these RBCs and causing all these which is happening. That is why this is called as a immune type of hydrops fetalis. The only thing you can do is to prevent this. But how will you prevent that? The main prevention starts when you have to prevent the sensitization. Because once the sensitization occurs, you can't do anything. The secondary response will definitely start for the next future pregnancy. So this sensitization can be done in the first pregnancy itself. When you come to know that the woman is a Rh negative status of blood group, after the first pregnancy or after the first delivery, you have to do the fetus or the newborn RH status. If the RH status of the newborn is also negative, then don't do anything because there's no antibody production, there's no sensitization occurring. But if this fetus is RH positive, there will be some amount of fetomaternal hemorrhage which is occurring during the delivery. Okay, it might have happened and you don't know how much it has happened. So at that time, you have to give anti-D antibodies. Intramuscular injection that has to be given within 72 hours, less than 72 hours. Because one, if you give more than 72 hours, it's usually not of much use because by that time sensitization would have already occurred. So it's not much of use. How does this giving anti-D help? So imagine this is the fetal RBC, which is having all the antigens. Okay, this is not the real shape, it's just a schematic diagram. This is a fetal RBC having the RH antigen on its surface. Now, if you give anti-D, those anti-D antibodies will bind to the antigens on the fetal surface. That means this antigen is not recognized as foreign by the maternal circulating system because the antigens are already masked by the antibodies which you have already given. And hence, it will act as a protective covering for the RBC and it will not be recognized by the maternal immune system and hence no sensitization occurs. So this is important for protection of subsequent pregnancies. So when all can you give this anti-D? You can give it after delivery, after ectopic pregnancy, after an abortion, after if you have done procedures like amniocentesis, external cephalic version. After all these procedures, you have to give anti-D because there will be some amount of fetomaternal hemorrhage and because of that, sensitization will occur. So for any case of RH negative pregnancy, prevention of sensitization is most important in protecting the subsequent pregnancies. That's it in this video. Thanks for watching. Hope it was useful.